Hello, Bea here, and welcome to Integrated Physics and Chemistry. I want you to imagine that you are speaking with a scientist, but they are not famous or well known. They are telling you all about a new theory about space that they have researched, and have even submitted a proposal to NASA to get their research funded. After that chat, you start talking to another scientist. Let's call him John. John is a famous astrophysicist. He starts talking about his new theory about space that is contradictory to the other scientist's theory. Well, John has also submitted a proposal for funding to NASA. Who do you think NASA is more likely to provide the funding to? Most likely John, because he has more professional influence and name recognition and is therefore the safer bet. Let's fast forward hundreds of years and find out that John's theory was actually incorrect and the other scientist was correct. But because the scientific community supports the more well-known astrophysicist, we lost hundreds of years of time in space research. That, my friends, is what happened in ancient Greece and the theory of atoms. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to understand how scientists developed the structure of the atom through research and by conducting experiments. Explain the current theory of the atomic model. Have you ever heard of Aristotle? Chances are the name is familiar. Aristotle was a famous ancient Greek philosopher. As one of the most influential philosophers of his time, he made huge contributions to science and ethics and even developed the original scientific method. Now, have you heard of Democritus? Probably not. Democritus was a contemporary of Aristotle and was also a philosopher. In fact, he was known as the laughing philosopher because of his studies on the value of cheerfulness. What do these two scientists have to do with atomic theory? Well, Democritus was actually the first philosopher and scientist to propose the idea of atoms. He said that atoms are indestructible pieces of solid. He came to this theory because he realized that if you break a stone in half, both halves have the same properties. Then he said if you keep breaking halves in half, eventually you will reach the tiniest piece, which he called an atomos, which means indivisible in Greek. Finally, Democritus theorized that atoms of the same material are the same, but that atoms of different substances vary in size and shape, as well as the idea that atoms are constantly in motion. Democritus was definitely onto something. Unfortunately for Democritus, Aristotle believed that everything is composed of four elements: water, fire, air, and earth. Since Aristotle was more influential at that time, his theory was the one more widely accepted. But today we know that Democritus was the one who was on the right track. Sounds like our situation in the opening, right? The next major moment in the timeline of atomic theory wasn't for over 2,000 years. In the early 1800s, a scientist named John Dalton developed his atomic theory. Building on Democritus' ideas, Dalton proposed four key points in his atomic theory. He said that, 1. All matter is made of tiny, indivisible particles that are too small to be seen. 2. All atoms of the same element are identical, and atoms of different elements are different. 3. Atoms can't be created or destroyed, but they can be rearranged during chemical reactions. And 4. Atoms combine in simple whole number ratios to form compounds. At the time of Dalton's theory, the electron, proton, and neutron had not yet been discovered, so he viewed the atom as a solid sphere, like a marble, that is so small that you aren't able to see it. The first subatomic particle to be discovered was the electron in the 1890s by J.J. Thomson. A subatomic particle is something that makes up an atom, in this case, the electron. Before J.J. Thomson's experiments and discovery in the 1890s, the atom was viewed as a solid sphere. But J.J. Thomson proved that there was more to an atom than that. In his experiment, J.J. Thomson used a machine called a cathode ray tube to shoot a beam of particles, called a cathode, through a tube. Without any outside influences, the beam will go straight through the tube. However, when J.J. Thomson placed a positively charged plate below the tube and a negatively charged plate above the tube, he found that the ray was attracted to the positively charged plate and repelled by the negatively charged plate. He proposed that since the particle ray was attracted to the positive plate, it must therefore be negatively charged. After his experiment, J.J. Thomson proposed the plum pudding model, but since plum pudding isn't really a thing anymore, you might not know what that is. So let's call it the chocolate chip cookie dough model. In his model, Thomson said that there were negatively charged electrons throughout an atom. These are our chocolate chips, and they are surrounded by a positively charged solid material, our cookie dough. Together, the negatively charged chips and the positively charged dough make the atom as a whole neutral. In 1911, Ernest Rutherford made what is possibly the most important discovery about atoms, that they are mostly empty space. Rutherford conducted the gold foil experiment. In this experiment, he had a thin piece of gold foil and planned to bombard it with positively charged alpha particles. Based on the current atomic model at the time, J.J. Thomson's plum pudding model, Rutherford expected that the alpha particle would pass straight through the atom because the positive charge in the dough was so spread out, it wasn't strong enough to affect the path of the alpha particle. What actually happened was a shock. Most particles did pass through the foil, as expected, but some were deflected and some even bounced straight back. Rutherford proposed that this meant that there was a small, dense, positively charged nucleus surrounded by mostly empty space that contained the electrons. Most of the alpha particles passed right through the empty electron space, but some came very close to the positively charged nucleus, and since the particle was positively charged too, it was strongly repelled. After conducting his experiment and seeing the results, Rutherford was shocked by what he saw. He was quoted saying, "It was almost as incredible as if you shot a 15-inch artillery shell at a piece of paper and it came back and hit you." After Ernest Rutherford's groundbreaking discovery, there was still one question that scientists were unable to answer. If the nucleus had a positive charge and the electrons surrounding it had a negative charge, what prevented the positive nucleus from pulling in the negatively charged electrons and causing the atom to collapse? Niels Bohr set out to answer this question in 1913. Bohr conducted numerous experiments with the element hydrogen and studied the results of similar studies and came to the conclusion that while Rutherford's theory was correct in some aspects, such as the idea that the atom is mostly empty space and that the electrons float around the nucleus, Bohr proposed that electrons move around the nucleus in fixed orbits. He also showed that the electrons closest to the nucleus have the lowest amount of energy, and that electrons farther away from the nucleus have the greatest amount of energy. Bohr's model has been named the planetary model because it resembles how the planets move around the sun in our solar system. In 1926, Edwin Schrödinger proposed what is our current theory of the atomic model, the electron cloud model. In his theory, Schrödinger proposed that electrons do not travel in exact orbits and that it is impossible to identify the exact location of an electron at any given moment. However, he was able to use probability to narrow down the location of each electron in an atom to specific regions, which he named clouds. He also determined that each cloud has a different energy level, building on Bohr's idea. Before we end our lesson today, let's spend a moment reviewing what we have learned. The discovery of the structure of the atom is a perfect example of the scientific process. Over hundreds of years, scientists tested theories, analyzed results, and shared their findings with their peers. They also worked to build on each other's research. Getting to our current model of the atom was a work of true collaboration within the scientific community. So, what is the current model of the atom? Our current model states that the nucleus is made of positively charged protons and neutral neutrons, and is small and dense. Remember, when something is dense, that means it has a large mass and a small volume. Surrounding the nucleus are negatively charged electrons. These electrons are constantly in motion with lots of energy and move around the nucleus in electron clouds, which are mostly empty space. In our next lesson, we will be going into a lot more detail about protons, neutrons, and electrons. As we went through the lesson today, we saw how scientists built on each other's work and knowledge to use technology and develop the current theory of the structure of the atom. In our next lesson, we will learn more about the subatomic particles that make up the atom: the protons, neutrons, and electrons. Until next time, remember that the universe is vast and full of surprises, so never stop exploring. See you next time! Hey, hey.